the big coverage. 20 years from Innsbruck 64 to Sarajevo 84, the Olympic tradition continues. 4 years have passed in all our lives, but the memories of Lake Placid are still crystal clear.
5 seconds left in the game. It's over. You believe in miracles? Yes!
Unbelievable. Memory, turn your face to the moonlight. Let your memory
memorable to me was when we all were on the podium and we listened to our national anthem and see our flag go up just a little bit higher than all.
Earth as it looked from the space shuttle Columbia. From this distance, it's impossible to believe that one patch of land must inevitably breed creatures superior to those of another patch. Even as the remarkable lens zooms in on one country, then one province, there's not that much to distinguish it from the rest of the world. But periodically, certain points on the globe are singled out for microscopic examination by the chance of history or a scheduled gathering of mankind. This week, the lens focuses on a city that history visited once briefly in this century, then seemed to forget. We're moving through the mountains surrounding Sarajevo, Yugoslavia, where the assassination of an Austro-Hungarian archduke lit the fuse of the First World War, and where this week, the athletes of the world are gathered for the 14th Winter Olympic Games. The cold, windswept loneliness of mountains in winter strips mankind of much of his pomp and pretense. Sports presents The Gold and Beyond. Tonight, we begin our examination of this test of human character and physical abilities, and at the same time, have the opportunity to learn something about a city that has been tested by fire and destruction. A city that now tries to move forward and find a new identity by playing host to a world gathering unique to our time. A gathering for the purpose of sport. The 14th Winter Olympic Games. There's the Sarajevo landmark as it looks on the eve of the games, the Ali Pashinya Jamia Mosque in the Basharshia, our old town. There are actually more mosques than there are churches in this town, and a couple times during the day, normally, you can hear the muezzin chanting from his minaret at the same time that the church bells are ringing all over town. That's Sarajevo on the eve of the Winter Olympic Games. Good evening, I'm Jim McKay, and I'll be occupying this chair at ABC Sports Control Center all through these 14th Winter Olympic Games. Just behind me, you see our control room, a bank of some 70 monitors in there with pictures from all of the venues, all the sporting events in these games, and behind the desks, the men who will make this great machine we have assembled do its work. Altogether, we'll have seen 63 and a half hours of coverage by the time the closing ceremonies end the games. Tonight, we begin, and we begin with today's crucial ice hockey game between the United States and Canada and the rest of our pre-Olympics program. Incidentally, many of you have indicated to us in the past that you would rather not know the results of events before you see them here. So I will not tell you the result or the score of today's hockey game until it is over on your television screen. So everything seems to be ready for the games. There's plenty of snow up in the mountains, although here in the city of Sarajevo, as you've seen, there's no snow at all. The athletes are here. We're here to show you the competition and the people. American prospects, by the way, have never been brighter all across the board. An intriguing addition to our ABC team this year is John Denver. Yes, that John Denver, the singing, songwriting one. John is a great singer, of course, but he also has a remarkable ability to communicate with people. He'll be doing that here, visiting the athletes and the people of Yugoslavia and bringing us back his special reports. He has also composed a special theme for ABC's coverage of the games. Here then is John Denver telling us the story of the gold and beyond.
Crystal morning, someplace close to heaven, on the side of a mountain, in a race for the sun. In a matter of moments, the dream of a lifetime is won. There's a fire in the heart, and it feels like a hunger. The spirit is burning, consumed by
beyond. This portion of ABC's coverage of the 14th Winter Olympic Games is brought to you by AT&T. We're reaching out in new directions. By Kmart. From quality merchandise to low prices, we've got it, and we've got it good. By Chevrolet. Official U.S. cars and trucks of the 14th Olympic Winter Games. Chevrolet and you taking charge. And by Beatrice Foods. Many of your favorite products come from us. Beatrice, you've known us all along.
You're seeing plenty of old familiar faces among our commentators on these Winter Olympics. You'll also see some new ones, experts who have been added to freshen our approach and improve our ability to tell the story. Let's meet some of our commentators now.
Hi, I'm Frank Gifford, and once again, in these Olympics, I'll be covering the alpine competition for both the men and women. And working with me once again, my friend, my colleague, the coach, Bob Beatty.
You know, Frank, I'm really excited about this Olympics. We have a really good American team and a chance for a lot of medals. And the first event's going to be the men's downhill on Thursday.
I'm Keith Jackson. I'll be covering the ski jumping here at the Winter Games in Sarajevo, and prospects for an American medal in jumping quite bright this time around. Speed skating as well, part of my job, working with 5 gold medal winner Eric Heiden. Eric, what about the speed skaters for 84?
Well, these are the Olympics. They happen only once every 4 years, and it's made up of individuals. So I think there might be some new surprises because nerves play such a big part of this.
And it is one of the great individual competitions in all of sport.
This is the Igman Plateau, high above Sarajevo. I'm Jack Whitaker, and along with Diana Nyad and Jack Turner, we'll be covering all of the cross-country skiing.
Hi, everybody. I'm Tim Brandt, and I'll be announcing the bobsled competition from here on Trebevich. Bobsledders may not be household names, but they are world-class athletes in a sport we all touched as children, Sam.
Well, Tim, I'm going to be covering the luge competition. Luge means sled, and these sleds go so fast they have to be timed to the 1,000th of a second. That gives you an idea of the precision involved.
Hello, everybody. I'm Dick Button.
And I'm Peggy Fleming.
And we'll be working with Al Michaels to bring you all the figure skating events from Sarajevo.
And our team looks very strong, and our expectations for medals are high.
Among our other commentators will be Kathleen Sullivan and Donna DeVerona. And who calls the hockey games? Well, who else but the man who called for you the memorable achievement of Team USA in 1980? A man who believes in miracles, Al Michaels.
The site is called the Zetra, one of two arenas for ice hockey in the 1984 Winter Olympics. And today we get underway the first game featuring the United States against Canada. Hello again, everyone. I'm Al Michaels, and I guess I have the same question most Americans do. Can it be done again? 4 years later, the United States seeking another gold medal here in Sarajevo. First of all, to win a gold medal, you have to reach the medal round. The U.S. has 5 games in its preliminary round, including 2 very big games right off the bat. Canada today and Czechoslovakia Thursday. The 12 teams are broken down into 2 pools. The top 2 teams advance to the medal round the final weekend of the Winter Olympics. The man who was the big hero in the Soviet game with a winning gold in 1980 is working with us now in 1984, Mike Arruzioni. And Mike, you know what it's like. You can relate, I'm sure, back to the Sweden game, same time 4 years ago. What must it be like for the U.S. team right now?
Well, this is everything that they've dreamed about, everything that they've worked for. They played a tough schedule. They traveled together for 6 months leading up to this point, up to the Olympic Games. This is where it's at for them right now.
Let's take a look at some of the individual standouts. The most publicized player has been Pat LaFontaine.
Well, he's their big man. LaFontaine scored 56 goals for them this season. If he plays well in the Olympic Games, they will do really well. If he does not score, they're going to be in deep trouble. He's the guy that leads them on the ice.
Feeling seems to be the top defenseman is Chris Chelios, number 21.
Well, Chelios is the type of player that can be just sensational in the Olympic Games. He played at the University of Wisconsin. He shined in the National Championship Series. He is a very, very talented offensive defenseman.
And what about a man you know very, very well, your former teammate, Phil Vrkota? He's back.
Well, Phil's the old man in this club at 27. He's the guy that they're going to count for leadership on the ice and off the ice. He scored 1 game-winning goal this season. That was the biggest game that they've played this season against the Soviet Union. He's the leader off the ice.
How nervous were you before the first game against Sweden in 80?
Oh, I'll tell you. You know, you just sit in the locker room and you're just jumping. Everything going through your mind. You're anxious, you're nervous, you're scared. You're everything that you can possibly be. And in a way, I feel bad for the guys right now because there are things floating in their stomachs that are incredible.
Another key man, of course, would have to be the goaltender, Mark Barron. We have our own goaltender back again. I'm delighted to be working with Ken Dryden, who within the past year went into the Hockey Hall of Fame after a tremendous career with the Montreal Canadiens. Ken, as the Canada game approaches right now, most of the publicity in the last 2 weeks has centered around the eligibility controversy. It has been resolved. What effect will it have? What has actually happened?
Well, after all was said and done, and there was a lot of that, there are 5 players that are now ineligible, and those are players who have played at least 1 game in the National Hockey League. There are 2 players from Italy, 1 from Austria, and 2 from Canada. Now, in many ways, that is a good result for Canada. I think they had resigned themselves to the fact of possibly losing 4 players. They got the 1 player they wanted very much, their goalie, Mario Gosselin. And in a way, no real martyrs were created. So I think there will be very little impact, no real emotional impact of that on this game.
We talked about Pat LaFontaine, what he means to the United States. What about the Canadian team? We hear so much about Pat Flatley, number 26.
Well, he's their top scorer on a team that doesn't have a lot of good natural scorers. And in many ways, he's the prototype Canadian player, the big, strong, tough winger. And how well he does out there may give a very good indication of how well the Canadian team does on this larger international surface.
One interesting aspect, the U.S. with two of its 20 back from 1980, the Soviets, who were favored to win the gold with 11 of 20. A lot of familiar faces are back in this tournament, at least from the Soviet Union.
Well, there are, and certainly the biggest face is their goaltender, Vladislav Tretiak. While many of the other faces are familiar, they're in now, have moved up to leadership roles. Tretiak is still that solid ground at the back, looking for his third Olympic gold medal.
The Soviets will open against Poland later today, but right now, coming up very shortly from the Zetra, the opening game in the ice hockey tournament for 1984, the U.S. taking on Canada.
Well, of course, that game took place earlier today. There's the mood downtown tonight, an anticipatory mood in Sarajevo. Coming up, though, that game between the U.S. and Canada. Now, before we go to our coverage of today's U.S.-Canada game, why did the achievement of Team USA in 1980 take on that extra dimension beyond the gold medal itself? Why did people literally dance in the streets, laugh and cry and sing patriotic songs? Well, for an in-depth look at that phenomenon, here's Jim Lampley.
Nearly 4 years later, when another American Olympic team played a different team of Soviets on the same ice, the celebration continued as though it had never stopped. A demonstration of national pride that had been touched off early on a February Friday evening 4 years ago.
Snyder, Buzz, long slap shot, saved by Mushkin. The U.S. team is depending a little bit too much now on Jim Craig. He's making too many good saves.
Arruzioni! Scores! Mike Arruzioni!
When the United States Olympic hockey team skates onto the ice in Sarajevo, few of us will resist the temptation to think back to what happened here in Lake Placid 4 years ago. For as compelling a group of sports events as the Winter Olympics are, the 1980 Olympic hockey competition was transformed into something much larger than a sports event the moment that Mike Arruzioni's goal hit the back of this net. Think about it. How many news events have there been in your lifetime of which you can say you know exactly where you were and exactly what you were doing when you first got the word? For millions of us who can't honestly say that we're hockey fans, this was one of them. Because the American Olympic hockey victory, and most especially the 4-3 win over the Soviet Union, touched a responsive chord among the American people and set off a spontaneous, explosive reaction. A reaction that, in retrospect, tells us a lot about how the Olympics relate to ongoing forces like nationalism and patriotism, and yes, politics.
February 13, 1980, opening ceremonies for the Lake Placid Games took place amid what had become a four-month cycle of mounting anger and frustration for Americans. It had begun in November.
The American hostages were blindfolded, handcuffed, and marched out on the U.S. Embassy's front steps by the revolutionary students. The Iranians had fought U.S. Marine guards for 3 hours for control of the embassy.
In December, Soviet tanks rolled across their country's southern border into Afghanistan. The invasion prompted Jimmy Carter to suggest in his January State of the Union address that this nation should boycott the Summer Olympic Games in Moscow.
And I have notified the Olympic Committee that with Soviet invading forces in Afghanistan, neither the American people nor I will support sending an Olympic team to Moscow.
3 weeks later, Carter dispatched Secretary of State Cyrus Vance to Lake Placid to ask the International Olympic Committee to move, delay, or cancel the Moscow Games. But the IOC would hand Vance a firm rejection. Now it was the very eve of the Winter Olympics. The summer boycott looked inevitable. We had grown accustomed to ending each day with a last reminder of our continuing troubles.
This is an ABC News special. The Iran crisis.
America held hostage. Day 100.
So that was the backdrop against which an anonymous American team skated on to play their little role in the small world of Olympic hockey. A world in which it was generally agreed they had no great prospects, no chance to win a medal. The crowd was sparse in the Lake Placid Arena on the night before opening ceremonies when they entered the final minute against Sweden, one goal down, and headed for probable elimination from the medal round.
Baker, number six, to Schneider, Buzz, back of the net, fighting for control of the puck with 29 seconds to play. Baker on it!
It all happened so fast. 10 days later, when they played the Soviets, they were on the verge of becoming a national passion.
11 seconds. You've got 10 seconds. The countdown going on right now. Morrow, up to Schultz. 5 seconds left in the game. Do you believe in miracles? Yes! Unbelievable.
They still needed to beat Finland 2 days later to wrap up a gold medal. But none of us doubted they would.
5 seconds to the gold medal, 4 to the gold medal. This impossible dream comes true!
And while the players celebrated their victory on the ice, the rest of us were celebrating something much more. It had started immediately after the win over the Soviets.
Good evening. It really was exciting. One of the most dramatic moments in sports, certainly in the history of the Olympics. The United States hockey team beat the Russians. After Iran, after Afghanistan, after inflation, we finally have something to cheer about.
In Lake Placid and everywhere else, we took to the streets to share something, a feeling we couldn't have described. On Monday, the players were at the White House. They went home to parades, like wartime heroes coming home from the front. In the weeks that followed, they became America's foremost sports obsession. As John Powers, co-author of a book on the 1980 team, recalls from that unforgettable Friday night, they had finally released our frustrations.
I remember going out into the night and seeing people with the kind of looks on their faces you get when you're about to go to war, and people thrusting fists up in the air and take that. And then there was an amazing amount of anger towards Iran, for God's sake. Most of it was not that we beat the Russians, but we beat everything that's been bugging us.
Cornell University professor Walter Lefebvre is both an author of history books and a hockey fan. He has studied the climate of a nation hungry for something to shout about in February 1980.
It's interesting to go back and to look at a newspaper the morning after the United States defeated the Russian hockey team. A national newspaper, like the New York Times, for example, right in the middle of the page is the story of the American hockey team's victory. On the far left of the same page is a story about Afghanistan. The next column over is a story about the American hostages in Iran. And then on the right are two stories, two column headlines, in fact, in the Times, about inflation rising at a more rapid pace than it had in American history up to that point. So it seems to me it's quite obvious that Americans looked at the hockey game as a way of saying to themselves, not everything in the world is bad.
And while the rest of us celebrated a political victory, there may have been only one small group in the entire country who will tell you they saw it as something less. They had skated and checked and shot, largely unaware of the reaction they had touched off outside Lake Placid.
I think when it really hit me was I was opening telegrams, and I got a telegram from a lady in Texas, and all it said was, beat those commie and blank. And, you know, it was just funny as an athlete to go on the ice and feel that we were playing a game politically when really we didn't. We never felt that, but yet all our fans sort of felt that.
I don't look at it as a victory politically in any way, as others do whom I've talked with. We won a gold medal, and that's about as far as it's going to go in my mind. But at the time, the country was down with the Afghanistan issue, and they just took a hold of this and tried to hang on to it for all it was worth.
I was playing a sport. The good Lord gave me ability to play something, and I played it, and I did the best I could. But I didn't play it because I felt that our government was better than their government. I played it because I love ice hockey, and of course I love my country, and I love to have an opportunity to represent them. But I wasn't representing them in a battlefield. I was representing them on the ice.
It is ironic that the players who produced the victory refused to recognize its politics. It is just as ironic that the man who coached them, Herb Brooks, did indeed believe that beating the Soviets proved a point larger than hockey.
I had a little smug attitude, and because I knew it was really more than a hockey game in the Olympics, regardless of sport. We, our way of life, our philosophies, our people, we don't have to be supported by the government. We don't have to prostitute our people just to prove our way of life is the best, which they do. It was, I thought that I felt something a little bit more than the athletic event itself.
The final irony is this. It was Brooks himself who had sold the players on a frame of mind that shut out the larger world.
That's the thing that I was just trying to present to the athletes. It is just an athletic game, and that's it. Because we had to have certain degrees of insulation of the political ramifications and the dynamics of any type of confrontations between the United States and Russia. So I wanted to build up degrees of insulation. And so, yes, I planted that seed and I stayed with that seed, but for me it was a little different.
So part of it was political, but there was more. We adopted them because they were from small towns and big cities. They included hotshot pro prospects and end-of-the-road minor leaguers. And through the prism of television, we could see that though we knew little about them, we knew them.
People remembered Craig and Ruzioni, but I'm not sure that they knew Neil Broughton from Mark Pavlich. But the idea was that these are all our kids. These are the guys next door. And the fact was, I think what made it interesting was that how many teams get together, have their moment of glory, and are gone the next day. It was literally that quick. They won the medal on Sunday, they were gone on Monday.
Maybe that's the most important point. They are gone, and so in a certain way are we. Just as Mike Ruzioni will never play another minute of Olympic hockey, the rest of us are beyond the anger of Iran, the frustration of Afghanistan. What happens here in Sarajevo will be a new story written by different people. They will reward us, but not in the same way as the hockey team which gave us pride, vindication, the return of our national self-respect. It would be wrong to say they gave us a gold medal and a victory over the Soviet Union. Those things belonged entirely to them, and always will.
There's another shot of one of our camera crews downtown in the old town. They're cooking something here called Cevapcici, the national dish. Kind of a mixed grill. Plenty of places to eat in Sarajevo. Now it's time for our first action in these Winter Olympics, the United States against Canada in an extremely important ice hockey game. Our commentator, Al Michaels.
The United States hockey team has just come out onto the ice at the Zetra Arena, getting ready for the start of the game with Canada. So the U.S. Olympic team on the ice waiting the arrival of the Canadians, and Mike Ruzioni is downstairs with Coach Lou Biro.
Lou, I'm excited. I know you've got to be excited. You've worked very hard for this moment. What are your thoughts right now?
Well, we got butterflies. I do anyway. It's always a little nerve-wracking the first game. I think the first 10 minutes will dictate the tempo of the game, and I think we're prepared, and the boys really want to win.
Good luck, pal.
Thank you.
There he is, Pat LaFontaine, just shy of his 19th birthday. As the United States hockey team gets set to take on the Canadians, LaFontaine, who played junior hockey in Quebec last year, will be joining the New York Islanders after the Olympics. The first of five games in the preliminary round for the American team at the Zetra Arena, and the flags are back. There are a lot of Americans here, a lot of the players' parents and relatives and friends, and the American flags a la Lake Placid in abundance. The starting goalies, can Mark Barron for the USA, Mario Gosselin for Canada. You've seen both of them.
I have. Mark Barron is a tall and very imposing goalie who's twice been an NCAA champion at Wisconsin and is a big game player. Mario Gosselin is about a half a foot shorter. He is bouncy and charismatic. He's sometimes hot and sometimes cold. You know, Barron is the better goalie. Gosselin is the type who can sometimes steal you a game.
Starting lineup for the United States Olympic hockey team. Ed Olczyk, David A. Jensen, and Pat LaFontaine form what is called the diaper line. They are all so young. The defensemen are Chris Chelios, number 21, and Tom Hirsch, number 22. We touched on the Canadian team earlier. Their key men would be Pat Flatley, number 26. Carrie Wilson, number 20, is also one of their leading scorers. Lowe, number 14, plays on the line with Wilson and Flatley. Bruce Driver, one of the defensemen, in a last-minute consultation now with Gosselin. The referee, interestingly enough, comes from the Soviet Union. His name is Yuri Karandin. And the linesmen are Tomas Mustrom from Sweden and Lasse Vanhanen from Finland. So 4 years later, we go at it again. The United States opening up against Canada. The games to be played in the preliminary round on alternate nights. The top two teams of six will go into the medal round, the final weekend of the Olympics. So here we go with LaFontaine, number 16, at center, flanked by David A. Jensen. And we say David A. because the U.S. also has a David H. Jensen. He's a defenseman, number 28, and we're underway. The Canadians have been moving left to right here in the first period, and Olczyk's slap shot goes wide. It's kept in at the point by Chelios. They try to work it to LaFontaine back of the net. The Canadians trying to clear it out of their own end. Chelios again comes in behind the net, tries to center it for Jensen, who couldn't get his stick down, and Canada comes out. Carrie Wilson, number 20. This is their top line. He has Flatley out in front, and Flatley scores. Flatley deflects it in, number 26. So Wilson and Flatley, the two big men for Canada, and just like that, 27 seconds into the game, it is 1-0 Canada.
Here you see the Canadian team breaking out. Carrie Wilson and Pat Flatley play very well together, and you can see it here. He waits for Flatley to get himself into position, the pass, and Flatley just tips it enough into the top corner behind Barron. Wilson again, with only one back, Hirsch, and there, Flatley breaking for the net, finding the top corner.
1-0 Canada in the first minute of the game. As Brooke, number 13 for the United States, has it back of the net. He's out of Yale, and in tests conducted earlier in training, he came out as the fastest skater on the team. Canada on top, 1-0, the puck in the Canadian end. As they work their way out now, a slap shot by Wood is swept aside. Brooke chasing it down in the corner. And Brooke comes up with the puck as the Americans start back the other way. The Vakota line is out there right now. And now another switch is the number two line featuring Gay and Bugstad. And Harrington is on the ice for the U.S. Number four is Doug Lipsky, the Canadian defenseman. Shot into the American end by Tippett as both teams change on the fly. And this is Fusco, who was the best college player in hockey last year at Harvard, to his brother Mark, who's a forward, number nine. In behind the net, Gosselin sweeping it aside. A minute and a half into the first period. Opening game of the Olympics, 1-0 Canada. Written out of the play by Redmond as Gay misses. Kept in by Iafredi at the point. The Canadians trying to take the pressure off. The Americans keeping it on here in the second minute of play. Fusco can't come up with the puck. Canada looking to clear it out towards center ice, but the U.S. with Gay and Bugstad finally pin it against the boards for a whistle. And Mike Arruzzioni, let me ask you what the effect of a quick early goal like that would have on the team like the United States at this point.
Well, you know, Elliot, the Olympics is such an emotional moment. Obviously, you want to jump out to as good a start as possible. And the Canadians, a team that has struggled in the past few weeks, I got to believe they really wanted that first goal so they can forget about the past. And I think that's a big step for them. That's something they probably wanted in this game.
Ken, what do you think?
That's exactly right. The Canadian state of mind has been a very fragile one. They have won only two out of their last 21 games. They needed a good start.
1-0 Canada with 17 minutes and 58 seconds remaining in the first period. The puck cleared out to center ice and back into the American end as Hirsch goes after it. Hirsch is checked. And the Canadian forward Wood loses his stick as the Americans come back the other way. And Chelios comes in as the U.S. is whistled down for offside. So offside, stopping the play with 17:28 to go in the first period. Davide Jensen, number 7. Shot in from the point by Chelios in the save. Canada trying to clear it. What they do? This is Flatley. Over to Carey Wilson. Wilson coming in. Fusco tries to take him out of the place. Still gets the shot away, and there's a save by Perrin. Now Fusco for the United States. To Bob Brook, number 13. A Harvard man playing with a Yaley. This is Olczyk sweeping in on the right side. To Jensen, who scores! David A. Jensen from Olczyk. And the Americans tie it with 9:50 to go in the first period.
Well, as we'll, I'm sure, see on the replay, Robin Bartel, a Canadian defenseman, gambled to try to intercept the puck off the boards. It bounced over his stick. And there's the final pass in front of the net, sending in David Jensen for the goal. But the mistake was made out around the center line, as without any real reason to gamble, the Canadian defenseman gambled, found the puck deflect off his stick, causing the near breakaway for the U.S. team.
David A. Jensen from Needham, Massachusetts, 18 years old. Jensen, Olczyk, and LaFontaine on that line. It was Olczyk who set it up. So the Americans, in a space of 10 minutes, are able to tie the game after Canada scores very early, 1-1, with 10:25 gone now in the first period. Vaughn Carpin for Canada moving in, and we're going to have a penalty coming up, a holding call. The second penalty of the game, and this one is against Ally Afraidy of the United States. So Canada will have a man advantage now for the next 2 minutes.
Here we can see the penalty. It's Vaughn Carpin of Canada swinging wide of Afraidy, getting a step on him, being thrown off balance, and the penalty is called. Very bad timing for a penalty, just after the U.S. gets the tying goal, just as you might expect a surge in their mood. Now they're put back on their heels with that penalty.
9 minutes and 24 seconds remaining in the first period. The Americans were unable to capitalize on the only previous power play in the game. Now Canada with a man advantage, and the U.S. is able to clear it out of its own end. To get it is James Patrick, who will set it up from back of his own net, the defenseman. He's hounded by Sampson. Gets it up ahead to Russ Kortnoff. Kortnoff skating in, has the puck poked away. Now Bruce Driver, his shot. They can't get a stick on the rebound. Still scrapping for it out in front. Another shot, and Barron makes a tremendous save as Chelios comes up with the puck, looking to clear it out to Hirsch. And he's able to clear it into the Canadian. But Barron made his best save of the game right there.
Yeah, and it'll be a save that'll make him feel very good.
Out in front, unable to get his stick on it, was Griffith, who might have had a chance to score a shorthanded goal, and he put one by Gosselin. Gosselin leaving it for Patrick now. It poked away, but Patrick moves it ahead down to center ice to Flatley. Flatley, by the way, played with Barron and Chelios of the American team at the University of Wisconsin. Flatley checked by Harrington. Lipster getting it to Wilson. Fusco is with him. 37 seconds remaining in the penalty. A shot is swept aside by Barron, and the rebound goes in. And the United States is going to contend that it's no goal. The Soviet referee, after the goal light went on, Yuri Karandin, pointing to the fact the puck did pass the goal line, did cross it despite Harrington's protestations.
A very weak backhand by Danio. A bit of a careless rebound by Mark Barron. I think he anticipated that the play was going to be a deflection. The argument is over the Canadian player in the crease, but given his positioning there, it seems likely that the U.S. defenseman probably knocked him over. And if he is knocked into the crease, then he has a right to be there.
7:58 now remaining in the first period. Canada takes the lead. 2-1. A similar beginning in the sense that when you go back to the first game in 1980, Sweden led 1-0. The U.S. tied it. Sweden then led 2-1. And the Americans wound up tying the game 2-2 on a goal by Bill Baker with 27 seconds remaining in the game.
Yeah,
whistle stopping play with 7:53 remaining to be played in the first period. 2-1, Canada.
Next program, well, we'll have a visit to the Olympic Village. We'll be going up into the mountains where the outdoor events of these Olympic Games will be taking place. Special piece on the security arrangements here. More of John Denver. A lot of things yet to come on the gold and beyond. I look forward to figure skating also. Now back to the hockey game, however, and Al Michaels.
First period, Canada on top by a score of 2-1 as you look at Phil Vrkota, the United States team captain, as he eyes the scene from the bench. Puck shot into the Canadian end. At the center ice now, Craig Redmond has to regroup. Gives it back to Patrick. He shoots it up ahead, but it's taken there by Hirsch. Griffith shooting it in over the blue line as Kumpel comes in. He's taken out of the play, however, by Patrick. Now Craig Redmond for Canada, number three. Now to Courtnall. He moves in. His drop pass is swept aside by Kumpel. He shoots it off the glass, and back come the Americans now with Scott Fusco controlling the puck. Taken away by the Canadians again as Flatley comes in off the left side. Flatley taken out by Fusco, but he's able to get it to Wilson. He's being ridden by the other Fusco, Scott, number nine. The two brothers both attend school at Harvard. Low now to Wilson. Wilson, a good pass to Flatley, and his shot is wide. May have been deflected wide. And the pressure is off now.
Watch there, just the kind of game the U.S. doesn't want to get involved in, a game along the boards. Pat Flatley and Kerry Wilson are much stronger, much more adept along the boards than is the U.S. team.
And then they've been able to manifest that here in the first period. Two-line pass for offside stopping play with 1 minute and 22 seconds remaining in the first period. An Ivy League flavor for the U.S. Olympic hockey team, the Fuscos, both from Harvard. And there's a Yaley, too. That's Bob Brooks, number 13. On the faceoff of the U.S., Corey Millen, as the Canadians are able to control. Patrick coming back to handle it. He's pressured by Vrkota, gets it up ahead, but it's taken there at center ice by Hirsch. Hirsch losing the puck. Chasing back of the net. Hirsch clearing it up along the boards, but it's kept in by the Canadians. The clock counting upward, not backward, as it normally does here in Sarajevo. So less than a minute now to play in the first period. Hirsch, he tries to pass it up ahead to Harrington, and it's offside. Harrington got tied up at the blue line. And just for a moment, Dineen started to mix it with Vrkota. These two teams, having faced each other so many times, know each other quite well. They met 12 times during the course of the pre-Olympic schedule and had their share of skirmishes.
They have, and they know each other very well from other years as well. Many of the Canadian players are products of U.S. colleges. As you mentioned before, several of them are teammates, and they do know each other. And you could tell as the games wound down towards the final game that they played against each other in Milwaukee, that the tempers were starting to get short, and they knew that something was coming up very shortly, and the big test, of course, right here.
Pat LaFontaine on the faceoff, but the Canadians control the puck. Doug Lidster gets tied up and the puck over the board. So again, a whistle for another faceoff with 39 seconds to play in the first period. The top line out there for the Americans to close out the first 20-minute session. Pat LaFontaine from Pontiac, Michigan, played junior hockey and rewrote the record book in Quebec last year. Islander draft choice will join the club after the Olympics, and we've got icing here with 29 seconds to play in the first period.
The last time these two lines were out against each other, the U.S. had a very good chance around the Canadian net. I'm a bit surprised with only 30 seconds to go in the period that Canada has put
their line out there, and they don't have that their more experienced line out against the powerful LaFontaine line.
LaFontaine, another faceoff for the U.S. This is Robin Bartel. Americans try to get the puck loose, but can't, as Lidster controls for Canada. His pass up ahead, over to the left side, and the shot goes wide. With 10 seconds now remaining in the period. Canada keeping the pressure on. Muller to tip it. Now LaFontaine up ahead. But that'll do it for the first period. So a not dissimilar first period to what took place at Lake Placid in 1980 when the Americans did not play what you would call a terrific 20 minutes. They trailed at that point 1-0. That game wound up in a 2-2 tie. This one after the first period stands Canada 2 and the United States 1.
More periods of hockey to come, of course, but right now let's turn to another subject. American prospects in figure skating here are the best in many years. Two gold medals are probable. There could be silver and bronze for the Americans also. To tell us about it, here are two former world and Olympic champions. You know them, Dick Button and Peggy Fleming.
If there's one sport here at Sarajevo that we should do well in, that's figure skating. We have chances for medals in all four of the categories, men's, ladies, pairs, and dance. In fact, not since the 1950s, the 1956 Winter Olympic Games, to be exact, have we had a chance to do so well. In that competition, we won 5 medals in the ladies and men's competition alone. And here, of course, we have an opportunity for medals in all four of the disciplines.
Yes, we have two current world champions, a past world champion, and a potential world champion. So we have a very strong team and should do very well here in Sarajevo.
And if there's one category in which we have an odds-on chance to win, that's the men's competition with a young man from Bowling Green, Ohio.
Scott Hamilton, 25, 5'3", and 110 pounds, is the reigning world champion. He won his fourth U.S. title just 3 weeks ago at the national championships, where he was subject to the same adoration and affection that has been showered on him since he first began to dominate the sport 3 years ago. As the front runner for the Olympics, he rarely gets a moment alone.
Well, you always want something you don't have. And what I don't have right now is privacy. I've really worked since the last Olympics to try to put myself in this position. I've gone everywhere I've gone, I've tried to skate well. Everywhere I've gone to win. I've gone to really improve on the last performance. I've done everything I can to be put in this position, so why should I resent it?
Backstage before a competition, he's like other competitors. Few see it, but he too stretches, warms up, just like everybody else. And even though he's the world champion, he too gets nervous. With the pressure, however, Scott maintains a sense of humor that he's become well known for. And it's that humor, along with other things, that makes him so endearing, especially to the ladies.
He's really cute and he's got great legs. They're really muscly. I love it.
If I could skate like that, I would just die. He can give me lessons anytime.
And it's not only the girls.
Oh, what can you say? He's the best there is.
Scott is like a bird. He just flies.
And when he takes the ice, they don't just cheer. They really get into it. And when he leaves the ice, the ladies are again waiting for him. Does Scott feel like a celebrity?
You don't sit in a rink for 4 hours a day doing compulsory figures with a runny nose and feel like a celebrity.
It's that humility and wit which are part of what's made Scott so popular. Here getting his last medal as national champion before going for a possible Olympic gold, Scott savored the moment endlessly.
My last time up here, I might as well enjoy it.
All right.
Dick, did you find some moments after you won to savor it?
You bet. You know, it's wonderful to see how well Scott has done over the last years and how consistently good he is today in all the categories of men's skating. I think that's the strength that he has. He's good in jumping and spinning and choreography and the compulsory figures and in the musical interpretation and the way he presents himself on the ice. And I think that if he didn't win here, that would be an upset.
Well, it's a little different story in the ladies' event. It's going to be very close competition, but we have a very strong team. We have three very good competitors from the United States.
19-year-old Rosalind Sumners of Edmonds, Washington, is presently the best ladies' figure skater
everything
in the world.
Everything relaxed, and let the leg relax, everything, and then you just start pulling, and it just pulls really, really tight. Robert.
As a world champion, she spends hours practicing, sometimes even going back to the basics, repeating them over and over again. It's her attention to detail that sets her apart from the rest and gives her that polished look. At the Nationals last month, it was this polish that helped her overcome a less than world champion-like performance to capture her third straight national title. But Rosalind has brought back to skating something that has been missing for a long, long time. It's that rare blend of both athletic and artistic elements. She has shown that the triple jumps alone are not enough to win. Elegance and style count too. Rosalind is a favorite for the gold medal here in Sarajevo. How she deals with this pressure might very well decide if she can live up to these high expectations. Every athlete handles this kind of pressure differently. How does Rosalind deal with it?
I just like a lot of excitement, a lot of hype. I like excelling in a certain area or areas, and it's just a great motivation thing for me, and I just want to strive to be the best person, the best skater, the best everything that I touch. I want it to turn into gold, but I want it to happen with the hard work and determination.
It's hard work and determination that's put Elaine Zayac in a top contender's role for the gold. We first saw her at the age of 13, winning the Junior Ladies National title. 2 years later, she had become the best in America, capturing the senior title. The next year, performing a record 7 triple jumps, she moved from 7th place to the top, capturing the world title at the age of 16. But the meteoric rise has been marked by periodic failures, inconsistent performances, motivational problems, and the difficulties of just growing up have characterized Elaine's up and down career. Most recently, with a chance to pass Rosalind Sumners and regain the national title, Elaine was down again and settled for 3rd place. Having experienced both peaks and valleys, she has a fighter's instinct. What is her attitude as she prepares for the biggest competition of her life?
I know that if I want to win this year, that it's up to me. And I'm not going to worry about whether this one's going to do this or that one's gonna do that. I just worry about what I have to do to win. And I know I can do it if I try. Because my dad always said, there's nothing that's impossible. And you never say you can't do anything. Because if you say you can't, then you won't.
The big surprise at the Olympics could be 16-year-old Tiffany Chin, charming both the judges and the audiences alike. Her stunning performance at the national championships won her a silver medal. More importantly, she served notice by beating both Zayac and Sumners in the short and long program. Only 4'11 and 90 pounds, her feel for the music is transmitted to the audience, and Tiffany immediately becomes a favorite. Might she be the Olga Korbut or Nadia Comaneci of these games? Tiffany dreams about it.
You know how you lay there at night and you get just the wildest dreams. And, well, mine is, I'd always a lot of times just picture myself being on top of the podium and having everyone clapping for me and yelling, yay, Tiffany, and having that gold medal around my neck.
The dream to become the Olympic champion. It's one shared by all the athletes in Sarajevo. Perhaps for one of these young ladies, that dream will come true.
Well, we certainly have a strong team from the United States. But the toughest competition for these girls is going to be coming from Katarina Witt of East Germany and Claudia Leissner of West Germany and Elena Vodorezova of the Soviet Union. So the competition is really between these 6 girls, and any one of these could be the Olympic champion.
And remember, there's one further complication. 3 of these girls are Americans, which means that if any one of them skates well, they could potentially spoil the chances of one or more of the other Americans. I think basically what it comes down to is which girl makes the fewest mistakes and skates with the most outgoing verve. If anyone does that, they'll be the champion. If not, it's going to be simply up for grabs.
You know, we see so much marvelous skating in the Olympics that it's only when you see something like Elaine falling there, as we did a minute ago, that you realize and remember how very difficult it is even to stand up on ice skates. Herewith, then, we're going to have a reminder that standing up on skates can be very, very difficult, even at the highest level. It sure can. Have a look. Honestly, skaters, we didn't want to make you look bad. It's just a reminder that it's a very, very tough sport. And those were some of the best in the world. Continue wearing our coverage. That's another shot in downtown. That's the old town where you can buy handmade copper items and knitted things, all that sort of thing. And you can buy it until fairly late into the evening, as you can see. Yet to come on our pre-Olympic show, well, of course, a lot more of the hockey game between the United States and Canada. We'll also be having more figure skating, a look at the pairs and the ice dancing competition. Special features, but coming up right now, we're going to have an ABC News business brief and also a word from your local stations around the country. Then we'll be back. Two of the most spectacular and dangerous sports in the Olympics are bobsledding, men inside those heavy rumbling machines at 90 miles an hour, and luge, men and women competing on sophisticated versions of a flexible flyer, also at tremendous speeds. Now, our commentators on these sports are more familiar to you in other locations. Tim Brandt, whom you've seen on the sideline at football games, and our automobile racing expert, Sam Posey.
This is Trebevich, high above the city of Sarajevo, nestled in the pines. In the summertime, it is a famous picnic area. Now it is the site of two of the most competitive sports in the Winter Games. Hello, everybody. I'm Tim Brandt, and I'll be announcing the bobsled competition, the two-man and the four-man. Bobsledders make up a worldwide fraternity, and although it is a small group of sportsmen, they are athletes bound together in a sport they so dearly love. They push their sleds to the edge of control down these tracks at speeds of nearly 80 miles per hour, banging the walls and being hit by a force four times that of gravity. But this track was not built solely for the bobsled. It is also the site of the luge competition. So let's go to my colleague Sam Posey to tell us about the luge.
Well, Tim, when you realize that the lugers, and this is a sport for both men and women in singles competition, men only in the doubles, they come down this hill flat on their back, a mere 6 inches above the ice, riding a sled that's tiny, their feet sticking out in front of them, their heads dangling out behind, and they are often going as fast as the bobsledders. You think about that, you could be forgiven for thinking these men and women are absolutely crazy. But when you come to understand more about the sport, and you understand the strength and the precision, the psychological control that's necessary, it can come to fascinate you. They dress like a combination of gladiator and ballet dancer, weighted with lead to increase speed, encased in a skin-tight suit to reduce aerodynamic drag. They are, literally, human missiles. In the moments before the start, the loser imagines the course in his mind, turn by turn, programming himself for what's to come. On the track, he steers with small shifts of his weight and by delicately pushing on the sled's runners at the inside of his legs. The more relaxed you can be, the better. Like a shock absorber, your body helps to keep the sled from bouncing on the ice. When something goes wrong, it is nearly always because of a lapse of concentration. Crashes are frequent. Serious injuries, fortunately, are not. Losers dislike being labeled as daredevils and insist that people unfamiliar with their sport vastly exaggerate its dangers. A loser is self-reliant, disciplined, and for all the mental aspects of the game, very much an athlete. The emphasis is on singles competition, but there is also a men's class for doubles, as bizarre-looking a sport as has ever been devised. Historically, the best losers have been German-speaking people. It was as if they had a sort of collective consciousness for what it took to ride the ice faster than anyone. But the Russians won a gold at Lake Placid, and the hottest loser in the world right now is this man, Russia's Sergei Danilin.
Sam, the Russians are also challenging the field in the bobsleds. The best times in this sport come from a combination of aerodynamically designed sleds and the athletic abilities of each team member at the crucial starts. But sleds were not always this fast, nor did they always look quite this way. The early development of the bobsled saw a completely open sled, more like a toboggan or large flexible flyer of today. In 1936, the sleds had a better defined steering system and looked sleeker than earlier sleds. 20 years later, the sled shape became more enclosed, weight was a key, and heavier team members were used until weight limits were established. Since those first sleds, science, speed, and the aerodynamics involved brought us to this present-day prototype, the Shark Sled, the Soviet Union's controversial two-man bob. Rumored to have been designed in an airplane factory, its shape resembles the nose of a hammerhead shark. The so-called Shark Sled may be to bobsledding what the rear-engine cars were to Indianapolis. They revolutionized that sport. The sled is much more narrow than conventional sleds, which lowers the air resistance, allowing for the faster speeds. The Soviets have also added another factor to the competitiveness of their sled. Each team member is a top track and field athlete, allowing for even faster starts and thus the faster time. Even though this is the Soviets' first Olympic bob appearance, it seems as if every other team is trying to be competitive with the Soviets. So other shark sleds are being built. The East Germans have succeeded in their own way, and because of their driving expertise, could be the favorites. The Soviets finished 1, 3, and 4 in the two-man European championships, and the Swiss will also be competitive. On Friday, February 10th, the two-man Olympic competition will begin. And 1 week later, the four-man competition will take place. We will then see whether the Soviet shark design is in fact the sled of the future.
Let's orient you in time again now. This is the night before the opening ceremonies of these Olympic Games. Tomorrow night you'll be seeing the opening ceremonies along with downhill men's ski racing training. And on Thursday night, it's action, action, action from there on in, beginning with the actual men's downhill ski race. There was, however, this one action today in which there was tremendous interest in the United States and in Canada, the hockey game between those two countries. So let's go back now for a recap of the first period from Al Michaels and Michael Ruzioni.
At the end of the first period in the opening game of the Olympic hockey tournament, Canada leads the United States by a score of 2-1. And Mike, I can't help but think back to the opener against Sweden in 1980 and how similar the first period was that night and today. Do you feel the same way?
Yeah, it seemed exact. You know, what happens when players are nervous and a little uptight, they tend to go back to their old style of play, which is up and down the wings. And the U.S. team does not play that style that well. They play a good European style where they skate and interchange positions. So I think Lou Vero, between periods, has got to get them back to that style of play because they're not going to win this game going up and down their wings. They've got to use their speed and their skating abilities.
The Canadians scored in the first minute, and the Americans tied the score midway through the first period. We're going to take a look at the goal first in animation and then on videotape, and it began with a pass from Ed Olchek to David A. Jensen.
Well, here's what happens. Olchek makes a nice feed to Jensen, and Jensen just sort of tips the puck in. But the reason the play was so successful is, one, because Jensen is such a great skater. Now watch this move by Olchek. See how he's on his forehand, pulls it to his backhand, and just gets it over to Jensen. See how Jensen is ahead of his man, number 27, Mueller, and he just tips it in as he's skating by the crease. Again, the reason the goal was successful was because Jensen is the U.S. team's fastest skater, and he gets in.
But then the Canadians were able to counter on a power play, and so at the end of the first 20 minutes at the Zetra, it's Canada 2 and the United States 1.
Mood. The coming together of nations for the purpose of sport that inevitably reminds us of how things might be. And because they take place in various places around the world, they also remind us of how things have been, of man's history, his achievements, and his cruelties. The sports and the history together make us think of man's current status and his hopes,
and aspirations for the future. So it is in Sarajevo, as Jack Whitaker reminds us. These young voices are singing the praises of Yugoslavia's greatest leader, Marshal Tito. Ago, the heir apparent of the Austro-Hungarian Empire spent his last hours sitting in this chair. During the Austro-Hungarian occupation, this building was the city hall, and it was here on June 28, 1914, that the Archduke and his wife Sophie came after an assassination attempt had failed that morning. A plot to kill the Archduke had been planned by the Black Hand Society. A homemade bomb thrown by one of its members missed the Archduke's car, hitting the one behind it. After delivering an address at City Hall, the Archduke's motorcade proceeded down the main street. No one told the lead driver that the route had been changed, and in the confusion, the motorcade came to a halt. On such mundane things do great events revolve. At that moment, a 19-year-old anarchist named Gavrilo Princip emerged from a coffee house, found himself 10 feet from the Archduke and his wife, and shot them dead. Gavrilo Princip's action unleashed the forces that sent the world on a deadly roller coaster ride that continues today. In effect, they buried the Austro-Hungarian Empire when they buried the Archduke, and the map of Europe was changed forever. 1 month to the day after the assassination, the Austro-Hungarian Empire declared war on Serbia. Germany backed Franz Joseph. Nicholas II of Russia backed Serbia. And off the world went on a dance of death and destruction known as the Great War. Before that war, independent Serbian and Montenegrin states bordered the Austro-Hungarian Empire. After that war and the fall of the empire, the kingdom of Serbs, Croats, and Slovenes was born. In 1929, the name was changed to Yugoslavia, meaning the land of South Slavs, and its stormy history can be traced to its geographic position. The Turks controlled the region for 400 years, and their influence is still seen. Sarajevo became a crossroads between East and West, and the rich mixture of religions and cultures created a background that erupted in the assassination of the Archduke on that June day so long ago. In April of 1941, Yugoslavia was again in the shadow of the invader. Hitler's army overran the country in 10 days. The resistance movement was led by Josip Broz, known as Tito. His partisans held down 40 German divisions through brilliant guerrilla tactics. At the war's conclusion, he was Marshal of Yugoslavia under the watchful eye of Moscow. In 1948, Tito resisted the attempts of Stalin to keep Yugoslavia under Moscow's thumb. Stalin then cut Yugoslavia off from relations with the Soviet Union and the Eastern Bloc. Tito did not give in, and his leadership enabled Yugoslavia to remain an independent socialistic state. Josip Broz Tito died May 4, 1980. He was 87. Today, he is revered by Yugoslavs of all ages. Those that remember him most fondly are those that fought alongside him during the war. Tito and those Yugoslavs who lost their lives in World War II are commemorated in memorial parks throughout the country. And for the story of one of those memorials, here is John Denver.
Thanks, Jack. I'm standing at the Vratca Memorial, which was built by the people of Sarajevo 3 years ago to honor the thousands of their fellow citizens who were killed in the Second World War. This spot was chosen because at that time it was a mass grave. "He was eaten by the dark at Vratca" was an expression that meant another one had disappeared. There are over 11,000 names inscribed on these walls. Perhaps in this year of 1984, at these 14th Winter Olympic Games, we can begin to realize finally the full potential of all that is offered here. There's a full moon over India, and Gandhi lives again. And who's to say you have to lose for someone else to win? In the eyes of all the people, the look is much the same. For the first is just the last one. When you play the deadly game, it's about time we realize it. We're all in this together. It's about time we find out it's all of us or none. It's about time we recognize it. These changes in the weather, it's about time. It's about changes, and it's about time. There's a light in the Vatican window for all the world to see. And a voice cries in the wilderness. Sometimes he speaks for me. I suppose I love him most of all when he kneels to kiss the land. With his lips upon our mother's breast, he makes his strongest stand. It's about to see it.
Incidentally, the numbers you saw next to the names on the memorial were the ages of the people who were murdered by the Nazis up in that valley. Some of them were as young as 4 years old. One of them was one. It's a sobering place at that memorial. Sarajevo, a place of often terrible reality, trying to find hope in a gathering of sportsmen. And we'll return to the sport in just a minute with the second period of the U.S.-Canada hockey game.
Arena. After the first period, Canada leading by a score of 2-1. We get set to start the second period. Pat Flatley scored for Canada 27 seconds into the game. Then David A. Jensen was able to tie the game midway through, but then Kari Wilson scored at the 12:02 mark on a power play. Canada leads 2-1. Ken, your thoughts about the first period?
Basically, I think the U.S. has made it easy for Canada. They've allowed Canada to play the kind of game that they play best, and that the U.S. does not play particularly well. As Mike alluded to previously, it is that up-and-down game, a game that is played along the boards and the corners in front of the nets. That is a traditional Canadian style of game. It is instinctive to a Canadian player. It is a game that the U.S. team does not play nearly as well. They simply have to find open ice.
And so if you were Lou Vero, would that have been the first thing you would have touched upon?
Yes, it would. Not just the first thing, but the second and the third thing as well.
That important. Okay, here we go. Start of the second period. Canadians will be moving from right to left here in the second period. And it's David A. Jensen who steals the puck to Olchek, and his shot goes skittering through the crease. Now Chris Chelios, his centering pass. LaFontaine got it over to Olchek, but it's Patrick digging for the puck along with Olchek and trying to clear it as Tippett now comes in to try to help out. LaFontaine with the puck to David Jensen, and his shot goes wide. Canada Canada trying to take the pressure off. So this period begins in similar fashion to the first, but then the Canadians were able to break out in a hurry and score. LaFontaine has it poked away. Shot in by Olczyk. Jensen nearly got his stick on it, but couldn't. And then a shot from in front by LaFontaine goes wide. Olczyk goes down. LaFontaine strapping for the puck, along with Olczyk, who's trying to pin it against the boards and finally does, along with Vaughn Carpen.
That's the kind of start that the U.S. team wants, with the pressure on the Canadian team. Canada has changed its strategy a little bit by moving the Flatley line, the Wilson Flatley line, off of the LaFontaine group for the U.S., and has now have Dave Tippett going head-to-head with Pat LaFontaine. Perhaps Tippett is a pesky player, he's a skater, perhaps that's the intention.
This line is centered by Corey Millen now for the United States. It was a good shift by the LaFontaine-Jensen-Olczyk line. They start the second period. Millen, the smallest player on the team at 5'7", 155 pounds. Early on, not many people thought he'd make the team. He was amongst the 20, and not only amongst the 20, but he is centering, at the moment, the number two line for the U.S. Shot into the American end, and as Brooke goes back to get it, we get the call for icing.
This is an important line for the U.S., Verkota, Harrington, and Millen. Oftentimes, when you get into a competition like the Olympics, the top lines have a way of neutralizing each other, and it is the lines that are least expected that come on that provide that crucial difference.
Millen in on the faceoff, along with Dave Gagne. And the referee calling for another faceoff. Again, this game being refereed by the Soviet, Yuri Karandin. The linesmen are from Sweden and Finland. Doug Lipster is ridden out of the play. It's centered in front. Busco goes into the corner with it. Now Millen centering it, but none of the Americans are there. However, it's kept in and shot in by Millen, and the save is made by Mario Gosselin. And down goes Driver with the puck underneath him. Bruce Driver from Wisconsin. As you look at Gosselin, up until last night, a major question as to whether he would be eligible to play. Remember, he was one of the original four they talked about on the Canadian team in terms of ineligibility.
Canada has been pretty careless. There's a weak pass right into the middle and created the good opportunity. Canada has made two bad passes at the start of this period, both resulting in good chances.
A minute 43 into the second period. Canadians leading 2-1. And the puck shot into the USN, and we'll have an icing call coming up here. Again, not to be redundant, but a lot of people only watch hockey during the Olympics. Icing is when you shoot the puck from your own half of the ice over the opponent's goal line. So we'll have a faceoff coming up. 1:52 gone in the second. Al Michaels, Ken Dryden, Mike Ruzioni at the Zetra Ice Arena. Canada on top, 2-1 early in the second period. The Canadians have yet to take a shot on goal, but now they do and score in the second period by Carey Wilson, number 20. So the Americans had dominated the first 2 minutes of the period. The first 2 minutes entirely played in the Canadian end, and as soon as the Canadians were able to clear the puck, they manifest it on a goal by Wilson.
Well, we're going back to a familiar story here. Here we can see, coming from behind, Al Iafredi has the puck. He's knocked off the puck. Canada controlling the boards again, working out from the corner. Pat Flatley finding Carey Wilson in the net. Exactly the problem that the U.S. team had in the first period, and they will have problems the rest of the night unless they can get the game out of the corners. There you see it again. Flatley pass, Wilson unguarded, no chance for Barron.
So Wilson scores his second goal. That line has accounted for all of the Canadian scoring as Bartel shoots the puck in. Canada on top, 3-1. 17 and a half minutes remaining in the second period. Donnelly's backhander is swept aside. Now Chelios. Over to Sampson. Hamilton is able to get it up ahead. But Bartel takes the puck away to Lister. Now to Dineen on a two-line pass. Offside is the call. And there is Carrie Wilson, who was the second leading scorer during their pre-Olympic schedule. Two goals today and an assist. 3-1, Canada. 22 seconds remaining to be played in the second period. Scene that is remindful of the one, of course, in Lake Placid. We're in Sarajevo, Yugoslavia, but a lot of the American players' parents and family, friends, have come by for the two-week Olympic hockey tournament. They are here in abundance. They're not particularly happy at the moment with the Canadians on top by a score of 3-1 as the game approaches the halfway point. U.S. in white, Canada in red. Bartel shooting it in, but the Canadian team is offside. As you look at Lou Vero, and I would imagine, Ken, at this point, this would perhaps be about the time that a little bit of concern would have to start to set in.
Very much so. This second period is taking on the pattern of the first period,
right,
which,
okay,
as we said before, is really the wrong pattern for the U.S. team. And I think that what must disturb him particularly is if Canada is going to go to a strategy of only using a few players, the least the U.S. could do is put the pressure on them, make them skate so that eventually they'll pay the price. Now they're not even skating so that they may never pay a price.
Second period started out promisingly, but now it's LaFontaine out of nowhere coming in. His shot is saved by Gosselin. Olczyk comes back with a puck. Out to Chelios. His shot goes skittering through and was deflected wide. And now Canada's able to take the pressure off with Kirk Muller, getting it up ahead to Carpin. And we're going to have a whistle and a penalty coming up here on Chris Chelios, number 21 of the United States.
Well, we have the same sort of pattern developing again, where the U.S. puts on some pressure, forces Mario Gosselin into a good save, and then Chelios penalty. So the tempo again is disturbed.
That's the second penalty against the American team.
But here we can see an unnecessary cross-checking penalty or interference. And Carpin, the Canadian player, was nowhere near the puck, out of the play, and Chelios gets the penalty.
2 minutes for cross-checking. Canada was able to capitalize on the only other penalty, a power play goal in the first period. The Americans have had one power play opportunity and failed to cash in. So for 2 minutes, the Canadian team will have a man advantage.
We have Coach Dave King of the Canadian team, who has had a very successful record. He was a coach of the Canadian University champion last year. 2 years ago, he was the coach of the Canadian junior team that won the World Junior Championships.
Second period approaching the halfway mark, as the U.S. team is able to clear it out of its own end. This is Harrington now, with the puck loose for the moment, back of the net. Now Vrkota with it. The Americans trying to kill off the penalty, and Mike, this is very critical right here at this point for the U.S. to kill this penalty.
Well, one of the main reasons is they cannot fall behind 4-1.
And Vrkota gets taken down, and all of a sudden, here goes the end of the man advantage for Canada. Vrkota nearly had a breakaway, and he was pulled down from behind, and so the Canadians will have to be sending Pat Flatley into the penalty box here, and that comes a minute 25 into the penalty against Chris Chelios.
Canada found itself in a very bad position, somehow losing the puck, and the U.S. with Vrkota were about to break in on a breakaway, and Flatley hooked Vrkota down in order to prevent the breakaway.
So now you've got 1:25 remaining as you look at Flatley. 1:25 left in the penalty to Chelios, and a 2-minute penalty here for hooking to Flatley, so the teams will be at equal strength for a minute 25, and then the U.S. will have a 35-second advantage. Hirsch to Millen coming in on the right wing. Corey stops. He's taken out of the play now by Bartel. And it's Dave Donnelly, number 23, getting it over to Dave Patrick, the defenseman. James Patrick in over the blue line. He has it taken away. Bartel again at center ice. Kortnoff has it taken off his stick by Hirsch. Hirsch coming in. Hirsch tried a back pass, but Millen was not able to get his stick on it. He was ridden out of the play, and back come the Canadians. Portnoy faking the slap shot, working into the corner. 37 seconds remaining now in the penalty to Chelios, and 1:07 remaining in the penalty to Pat Flatley. This is Portnoy now, number 18. His shot, six save by Barron.
With only 4-on-4, you have that much more open ice. And it seems like they put their good skaters on.
And this is Tippett, who has a breakaway. His shot goes wide. Tippett missing the net on a breakaway that could have made the score 4-1. And that's the most fortuitous moment of the game for the Americans. They were that close to being down by 3.
Well, Dave Tippett found himself wide open right behind the U.S. defense, had plenty of time, made a weak shot and missed the net fairly considerably. As you said, Al, it was a crucial play, and it works. It certainly backfires doubly for the Canadian team. Not only do they not get the goal, but there's considerable life generated in the U.S. team from that.
Absolutely. Now the Canadian team knows it leads by 2, could lead very well by 3, and the reverse effect for the United States unit. Meanwhile, just 5 seconds remaining in the penalty to Chelios. He'll be coming out, and then the Americans will have a man advantage for 35 seconds. He's on the ice. It's LaFontaine, who can't get his stick on the pass from Brook, or all of it anyway. His shot was deflected wide. 25 seconds remaining now in the American power play. Busco can't move it toward the middle of the ice surface as Jensen comes in to help out. Now it's Busco again. And a good job being done on him by Kirk Muller, number 27. 12 seconds remaining now in the U.S. power play. And 9:19 left in the period. 3-1 Canada. But that has been effectively killed off right there as Barron is able to make the save. Flatley will be coming out of the penalty box in 1 second, and you will see him come back onto the ice as Jensen comes sweeping in, but gets taken down by Craig Redmond and couldn't get the shot away. So the teams are now skating at equal strength. Under 9 minutes to play in the second period. Canada leading 3-1. Back with Tom Hirsch, the defenseman, 22. Up ahead to Pat. He can't control it with his stick. Stepped in by Dineen. Backhander by Gagne goes wide. Then the shot is saved by Barron off his pad. Rebound still loose in front. Another slap shot, and that one goes wide. A golden chance from out in front. The U.S. taking the pressure off by clearing it out to center ice. And now Dineen back to Gagne. Down the right side, Lowe returns it to Gagne. And it's cleared out by David A. Jensen. And we've got an offside. A penalty is the call. A penalty coming up against the Canadians. Number 19, Gagne, who had a shot from right out in front just a moment ago, is sent off for tripping. 2 minutes for tripping.
It was an accidental trip, but it could be a very costly one for Canada. In pretty good control of the game, halfway through the game, being in the offensive zone, you can see Dave Gagne there talking to himself.
So for 2 minutes, the Americans will have the advantage. They didn't look particularly adept on a power play opportunity in the first period. Scrapping for it along the boards, and the puck is tied up.
I know one of the concerns with Coach Lou Vero and also the rest of the U.S. contingent was the scoring ability of the other lines, the non-LaFontaine lines. And tonight, the only real opportunities have been generated by the LaFontaine line. They're going to have to start to generate some production from the other lines.
U.S. with a man advantage for the next 1:39. Slap shot and a save off the glove of Gosselin. as the Americans try to keep the pressure on. This is Bjugstad skating in. Lidstrand got his stick on it, but the Americans are able to keep it in the Canadian end. Bjugstad again, looking inside. Busco, and then he shoots it back to center ice, missing Chelios at the point. Mike, what about the American power play at this point?
Well, it looks like they're trying to set up down deep and then try to slide it across the crease.
This is Brooke skating in, and Brooke has it swept aside by Gosselin, who also loses his glove, but is able to pick it up before the Americans can get a shot on goal. Mark Busco, his shot is deflected wide. Brooke trying to keep the pressure on. Out it comes to the point. Slap shot from there is deflected in front of Gosselin, and it's Brooke once again now. Nice pass to Bjugstad, but his shot is blocked by Bruce Driver, who went down to the ice surface. 37 seconds remaining in the penalty now. Shot Busco. And it's shot out into the American bench, stopping play with 32 seconds remaining in the power play.
Just the thin width of the shaft of the stick there that prevented a good wide open chance in front of the net. As Mike was saying before, how they're trying to set somebody up in front of the net. They had him there, but the Canadian defenseman blocked it.
6:35 remaining in the second period. A half a minute remaining in the power play now. With Gagne in the penalty box for Canada. Chris Chelios has the puck for the United States. Canada on top, 3-1. LaFontaine skating it over the blue line. This is David A. Jensen with the puck, but he has it poked away. Back it comes to the point now. Over to Chelios. Chelios looking inside. It's Olchek now, who's able to just barely keep it in. Now to Jensen in front. He scores! Jensen had it initially saved by Gosselin, but it trickled out of his glove and into the net. And the Americans make it 3-2. And that comes with 3 seconds remaining in the power play. And 6:06 remaining in the second period. And here in Sarajevo, we have the chance of USA, USA.
So Olchek keeps the puck in, and it's a two-on-one situation right in front of the Canadian net. And Jensen puts it away.
Gosselin making the initial save. I thought initially he got his glove on it, but it got caught up in his underarm and then trickled down and over the goal line with a red light coming on as Jensen scores his second goal of the game. Get it up ahead to Muller. Bob Brooke and Bjugstad in the corner for the United States. Pass goes off the skate of the referee. And the Canadians are able to drop it back into the American end. They'll be content, obviously, to go into the locker room with a 3-2 lead at the end of the second period. 17 seconds and offside here as Pat Flatley almost made it a 4-2 lead, or had a chance to anyway. And then there's some contact after the whistle. So Pat Flatley, and we said it before, he and Bruce Driver, number 25 of Canada, Chris Chelios of the United States, number 21, and the goalie, Mark Behrend, all played at the University of Wisconsin.
Obviously, Mark Behrend knows Pat Flatley very well from practice, knows his style of play, as in fact, as we've mentioned before, these teams know each other. However, the U.S. now still with 15 seconds to go.
As Driver's slap shot is swept aside by Behrend. Less than 10 seconds remaining now in the second period. Clock here in Sarajevo goes the other way. And at the 20-minute mark, that means zero. That's the end of the second period. So we've played 40 minutes with 20 to go at the Zetra, the opener of the Olympic hockey tournament. It's Canada 3 and the United States 2.
So that's the way it was at the end of the second period. One period yet to be seen on our program tonight. Well, it would be nice if sport and brotherhood were all at these Olympics, but the realities of the so-called real world intruded on the games in 1972 at Munich, and they've been with us ever since. What about security here in Yugoslavia? Well, Kathleen Sullivan of ABC News, who will be co-hosting our late-night show along with Jim Lampley here at these Olympic Games, has a report on that. It begins with a day that all of us who were there wish had never happened. September 5th, 1972.
This is building number 31. And we're moving in now on the windows behind which, at this moment, 8 or 9 terrified living human beings are being held prisoner.
Videotape of that tragedy in Munich has been dissected frame by frame by organizers of these Sarajevo games. In fact, since 1972, intense security measures have become critical, ensuring that the athletes and their performances remain the central focus of these games.
I'm glad there's security, and I'm glad that it's tough. I certainly wouldn't want something to happen here, and my feeling is if there's going to be a target around here, I guess the good old USA would be the number one, especially with what's been going on in the world lately in Lebanon and et cetera. You can see that there's a guard up there. There's one guy usually up in here. There he is, behind one of the bunkers, and there's one guy down there. So you have three guys over a 400-yard area.
At the Olympic Village, security is especially tight. Machine guns have been issued to police solely for these games. Some security measures may be inconvenient, but seem to be carried out in a courteous fashion. All vehicles are checked for explosives. Even athletes' equipment like this luge get the once and the twice over. And before these cornflakes reach the breakfast table, they must first be x-rayed. Security is virtually everywhere. At Sarajevo's airport, all bags must be screened. At hotels, luggage is screened again. Visitors are required to pass through metal detectors. Yet with all these precautions, do the athletes feel secure?
If they really wanted to create something here, it would be easy to do, you know. It's not that safe anywhere, even if you got guards posted 24 hours a day with machine guns all around you. You're never going to be safe.
Army troops at the sports events have no specific security role, although their presence is a visible deterrent. Helicopters can only scan through the treetops, so foot patrols must march along those icy roads. In Sarajevo's old town, athletes relaxing from the day's competition may be somewhat vulnerable. But there still is that presence of security, albeit subtle this time. The people of this city have all been reminded that the safety of their visitors and the Winter Games is their responsibility and have been told by authorities to watch out for suspicious activity.
We have been prepared all our lives, you know, to defend the freedom of this country. It was a tough job for centuries, and we are trying to keep it safe and keep it as is forever. So, Olympics or no Olympics, we are always ready.
Sarajevo may be naturally protected by a picturesque mountain range, but Yugoslavia is not isolated from countries which are home to political terrorist groups. So far, there have been no specific threats to the games, but Red Brigades and Armenian separatists in the region are two main groups being closely monitored by Yugoslavian authorities with the help of international security agencies. Last week, West German authorities arrested 12 Serbo-Croatian nationalists, a crackdown, we are told, to ensure the safety of these games. White House officials, members of the Los Angeles Organizing Committee, and U.S. security teams have all been in Sarajevo to check on the security measures. No doubt the effectiveness of those measures will be closely monitored in the United States as Los Angeles prepares to host the Summer Olympics.
Kathleen Sullivan on security. In a minute, we'll turn to a lighter subject, if you will, with that famous scientific researcher, Hughes Rudd, taking a lighthearted look at a very serious subject here, Slivovitz. Every country in the world has a clear liquid that's soothing to the spirit for a while and later very often devastating to the head, whether it's called vodka in Russia or schnapps in Germany or tequila in Mexico or gin in the United States, the effect is the same. Now in Bosnia, the area where we are now, the local white lightning is called Slivovitz. Hughes Rudd, a student of local folklore, found that Slivovitz making is also an example of how private enterprise can exist in this communist state. Here is his sociological report.
This man is not Lord Calvert or Johnny Walker. No, he's Mahmud Streak. He's 42 years old, has never married, lives on a 7-acre farm in the hills above Sarajevo with his sister. They have an orchard of fruit trees scattered down the hillside, and in summer they grow vegetables. But Mahmud's main occupation is the passion of this part of Yugoslavia, Slivovitz. When Mama gets a good fire going under his still, he dumps in fermented plums and water, then lets the mixture cook. The joints in the still are sealed with flour paste. More than two-thirds of all the slivovitz drunk in this country is made this way because agriculture is in private hands here and there's no tax on homemade booze. When the stuff starts to drip out of the condenser, it's filtered, sort of, through a cloth. Not the most hygienic of conditions, maybe, but we're talking moonshine here. Mammut checks the brew for strength and flavor. Now, some people think slivovitz tastes like gasoline, but that's not fair. It really tastes like kerosene. Everybody here says slivovitz is good for chills and fever, rheumatism, you name it. Not necessarily as a drink, but as a sort of rubbing alcohol. Well, with an interpreter lady, we asked Mammut's neighbors about that.
Have they heard of that kind of thing? Did you ask them?
Kaže da je čuo da se šljivovica koristi za lečenje kao narodni lek, da skida temperaturu, da može se stravlja leđa.
Šljivovica sve liječi.
Everything.
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 To zero in on this idea that slivovitz is a cure-all, we sat down with Mammut and asked him exactly how you use it.
Ukustavi se, znate, i...
He's saying his product is good for the blood vessels, for the circulation, for rheumatism, lumbago, the common cold, and sore throats. He also says his slivovitz won't give you a hangover, but that's probably just salesmanship. Anyway, the last we saw of Mammut, he was making a delivery to the neighbors. The doctor doesn't always make house calls up in the hills, maybe, but the slivovitz man obviously does. Well, we're not sure whether slivovitz will really cure all those ills the Yugoslavs seem to think it'll cure or not, but it does give you at least the illusion of well-being. After four or five belts of this stuff, you figure you could take on the world's biggest ski jump, drive a bobsled, or walk on water. This is Hughes Rudd for ABC Sports.
Well, I had an interesting adventure myself here in Sarajevo. Had to do with two friends of mine, men you know very well, too. They asked me to meet them to do their preview, and, well, here's what happened. This can't be the neighborhood. That's what they said, huh? That's it. 22, name on Yina. It's impossible. Let's see. Only one way to find out. This can't be the place. Have you seen two Americans? No, I don't believe this. Only get rid of the Addy. Boy, do they need an anti-smoking campaign in this country. Excuse me.
Hey, Jeff!
There you are.
Come on in.
Excuse me. Thank you.
He's our guy.
Thank you. What's going on? You're in one of these things done on location.
Well, we are on location.
This is your location?
That's it, baby. We've been working on the event.
My beer?
Yeah, we got a beer for you.
Okay.
Chivoli. Chivoli. Chivoli.
Now, hold it. Let's get serious. You guys got the downhill Thursday morning.
Hey, Jeff, it's all downhill from here.
Yeah.
We do?
I mean, we do.
Yes,
we
do.
We got a downhill for you.
It's a great downhill.
76, Franz Palmer, he's back, and he's really on the roll, too.
I'll tell you, he could be the first guy to repeat as an Olympic downhill champion.
Never been done.
No, you know, most Americans think he's an American anyway, so we've kind of adopted him.
We saw him at the Honeycomb in Kistel, and he was something.
That's right.
And there's some tough ones in there. I mean, it is only Klammer. The Austrians have got a bunch of them.
The whole Austrian team, the guy that won the race here last year, the pre-Olympic race, Waffenbeekler, probably is not even going to make the Austrian team. They have so much depth that that's one of the tougher jobs for an Austrian to be one of the four guys. And the Swiss are very good. They have a guy named Urs Reber. And I'll tell you, he's built like a fire hydrant. He's got bigger thighs than Earl Campbell does.
Earl Campbell looked like a Boy Scout.
And he is strong, too. He could really do well here.
And, you know, I'll tell you, we've got perhaps the finest... Well, the jury is still out, but maybe the finest downhiller America's ever produced in young Bill Johnson. He won at Vingen and the Lauberhorn, a tough race, and the Europeans, who's this guy? And they thought, well, a flash in the pan. But a few days ago, Jimmy, he came back at Cortina, finished fourth. He beat Franz Klammer, among a lot of other world-class downhillers.
Well, you know, the thing about him, he could. And the thing that's interesting about him is, you know, when he won the first one, they said, ah, this is a fluke. But then he came back and got that fourth place that Frank just mentioned. So people are saying, hey, wait a minute, we got a guy to worry about. And I'll tell you, he's a real bull, and this downhill is just made to order for him. So he could surprise.
I'll tell you what else, the giant slalom. Ingemar Stenmark is out of it. He's disqualified from the Olympic competition, as is Mark Giardelli. Right. They're the best slalom skiers going right now.
Slalom and giant slalom, but the thing is that they're not really disqualified as much as they really didn't qualify in the first place.
Right.
It was their choice. We're going to be talking a lot more about that later in the games. It's an interesting
subject. But it really opens the door for Phil Mayer and Steve Mayer. It really does.
I think both of the Mayers, they've both been struggling a little bit this year. They haven't really skied up to their potential. But if they do, then they're going to win some medals here, which is, I mean, what more can you ask?
No American man has ever won a gold medal. We could do it right here. We could get a couple of them.
What about the slalom?
It could be good. Also, there's one guy in giant slalom I should mention, and in slalom too, a guy named Zubergen from Switzerland. He's a youngster, only 21 years old. And many of the people I've talked to, many of the coaches over here, say he's as good as Jean-Claude Killy was at the same age. And I'll tell you, that's a lot to say. He's one we really have to watch.
And the story holds just about the same for the slalom, too. The Mayors, either one of them could win it.
And we have Yugoslavia.
I was going to say, what about
John Grigaj?
Grigaj, guys.
Could he do something, really?
Oh, yeah. He's been skiing very well this year. Probably as consistent as anybody besides Stenmark on the whole circuit. So he could win. Can you imagine the Yugoslavians up there if he were to win a medal?
Bananas. Oh. Cowbells will be eating them. No
should be terrific.
The gals are great, too.
I want to ask you about the girls as soon as we return to this small cafe in the heart of downtown Sarajevo.
Research Center.
Grisha.
What about you? I told you to get over here with that.
We are back, in fact, at the Copy of Summer on in the... No.
Our guy. We are back at the Cafe
Summeron in Sarajevo, and we're going to get serious again. We're previewing alpine ski racing in the Winter Olympic Games. Women's variety now. For the first time, as I understand, the women's events will be on an entirely separate mountain from the men's.
Unbelievable.
Separate but equal, of course.
Yaharina, and it's a good mountain, too.
Say the other mountain.
The Lajnica.
Oh, you did it.
I've been practicing.
We have cameras square, Jim, and our technicians. They've done such a marvelous job. Yeah, it will be that. And I'll tell you, it's going to be a great year, both Bob and I feel, for the U.S. women. The downhill, I think, sentimentally, we have to pull for Cindy Nelson. She has given us so many thrills. And what a story she's been for the U.S. ski team for so many years.
Also, you realize that in December, she hurt her leg and pulled her knee, really, tore it apart in Valdez there, training for downhill, in the downhill race. She went home, went out to California to see Dr. Stedman, the team doctor, and she's back, came to Megeve last week. She hasn't skied very much. She had a brace. It's going to be operated on in the spring. She's going to try to race here. She raced in the giant slalom, Michelle. She told me she was just scared to death, but I'll tell you, my hat's really off to her. She's one tough cookie. And
realistic,
great girl.
Though. I understand the other girls painted the brace gold.
That's realistic. Holly Flanders has a shot here, don't you think?
Yeah, she's been second in the downhill, and of course, she's from a great place. She's from Manchester, New Hampshire, my hometown, you know.
The city dropper.
But the Americans won't be the favorites, right, in that?
No, really, it's going to be Wolliser of Switzerland. She's been the most consistent on the circuit this year, but there's a young Swiss girl who's only 17 years old, and I'll tell you, she's really been good.
Tell me, what's her name?
Did I forget? Pagini. And I tell you, a lot of people think she's the brightest new star on the horizon.
Okay, but now GS and slalom is where we really shine.
We could literally go 1-2, gold, silver, or 2-1. Tamara McKinney, Kristen Cooper, or reverse it. I mean, they're dynamite, and they're coming into this perfect, wouldn't you say?
Oh, yeah, and I think particularly Kristen Cooper has been the most consistent girl on the circuit this year. And, you know, you talk about Cindy Nelson, and Cooper really has been amazing. She really screwed her knee up last year. She has to have had a wedge. Took a piece of bone out of her hip and wedged in below her kneecap. And a lot of people said, oh, she'll never come back. And I'll tell you, she's been great, and she's tough and coming into this event very, very strong.
They will, however, have strong opposition.
And as far as, well, Tamara McKinney also, I might just want to say one word about, because I still think she's the biggest talent I've ever seen in slalom and giant slalom. She's the World Cup champion, first one the United States has ever had. And she's going to show us a lot, I think, too.
In the slalom, you mentioned the competition. We could do 1-2 there also, but there's a little gal named Erica Hess.
Erica Hess is
fantastic. She is dynamite.
And she's been very good this year. The whole Swiss team is good, particularly the Swiss women's team.
But in the slalom, Kristen Cooper and Tamara McKinney are both, they're superb. They really are.
So that's a quick look at the women's competition. And don't forget, the men's downhill will be on Thursday night. Don't miss that. So, you guys going to eat here or what?
Don't you miss it either.
Are we going to eat here?
Oh, you know, Jim.
I'm starved.
Mm-hmm. You know that rooster's been waking you up about 3 o'clock every morning?
Outside all the hotel, lives across the street?
Yeah. The big rooster?
Yes. Yeah. I went out last night.
He's so big without a
I took care of him.
You mean baked or boiled?
Fried, I think.
Got it. Go phone.
Jibbly.
Jibbly! Mozart, Frisai!
Oh, don't you know they got the wrong bird? Our rooster is still up and at him, and he gets up real early. Keep you up to date on him. Let's start to figure skating again now. Pair skating specifically. Favorites for the gold medal in that, Elena Valova and Oleg Vasilyev of the Soviet Union. They're the world and European champions. Favorite for the silver, Sabina Bass and Tassilo Tierbach of East Germany. However, there is a chance for an American medal here. Peter and Kitty Carruthers out of Massachusetts by way of Wilmington, Delaware, won the world championship bronze medal 2 years ago. However, last year, they lost that medal to Underhill and Martini of Canada. But they're back again. They seem to be better than ever. Brother and sister, extremely talented. Peter, very strong. And Kitty, one of the most daring people in skating. Several people in the sport have told me nobody has more guts out there than Kitty. She'll try anything. The Carruthers, contenders for a medal. Bronze, maybe even better if they get real lucky. Now, there's a report that they may try a quadruple throw in the competition. Nobody's ever done that. It could move them up. Now let's turn our attention from pairs to ice dancing. Many people think of ice dancing simply as ballroom dancing on ice, and once upon a time, it was that. But today, ice dancing has shed that image and is now a highly stylized sport. The sport's leaders and innovators are Jane Torvill and Christopher Dean of Great Britain. Torvill and Dean, they've become the dominant figures in this event, much like Scott Hamilton in his event, primarily because of their inventiveness and creativity. Like this. Each year, they thrill audiences by unveiling new and exciting performances in a sport that has branched out in many new directions. Torvill and Dean in action. Now here's Dick Button.
Although ice dancing has been an important part of skating for over 100 years, it wasn't until the 1976 Olympic Games that it became an official Olympic sport, when Pakhomov and Gorshkov won the gold medal. Once considered the easiest of the four disciplines, ice dancing has now become the most creative and entertaining of all the categories. It's grown in many new directions. We asked Ludmila Pakhomova how she feels about the changes in her event.
It has to retain its own essence. Let people experiment. Let them look in new directions for new means of expression. That's good. There should always be people searching for something new. But it should be done for the benefit of ice dancing. Ice dancing should not be turned into a type of pair skating or a type of show or a type of entertainment.
And the rules were designed to do just that. England's Torvill and Dean believe you can preserve the art of ice dancing while moving the sport forward. Last year, they performed this back somersault. Not even the pairs or single skaters are allowed to do a back somersault, yet the judges gave them a whole mess of sixes. Many people feel they pushed it too far.
Their dance last year provoked some storms, discussions, arguments, because in many ways the dance was unusual. They incorporated some movements which were on the border of, and in some instances actually broke the existing rules.
It's their opinion. I mean, that is what judging and skating is all about, is personal opinion, and we can't influence it. We are as we are. You take us or you leave us, and that's really the only answer we can give. As regards certain rules, that is their interpretation.
Of the rules.
Of that rule. And our interpretation is otherwise.
By having a somersault, maybe they think that that was totally illegal, but also in the rules, if you're doing a move at the end of a free dance that's in character with what you're doing, then it's acceptable. And all the judges were aware of that fact, which is why we weren't penalized in any way for it. But you won't see any somersaults this year using Bolero, because somersaults have nothing to do with it. But for the circus, they were right.
Last year, Judy Blumberg and Michael Siebert of the United States also began to break away from the more traditional styles of ice dancing. And this year, our four-time national champions will skate to a single piece of classical music. There won't be any ballroom style about it at all. It'll be music, which further stretches the historical interpretation of the rules of ice dancing. The judges have awarded these changes with brilliant marks.
It's saying if you stretch it and you stretch it well and in the correct manner. I mean, we're not out there doing pair skating. We are doing ice dancing to a piece of music that might not have been considered ice dancing before. But because we are dancing, it's fine. And it's good because it's a positive end step.
I guarantee it, ice dancing will be among the most exciting and entertaining sports in these games, and we'll be seeing a lot of it. Yet to come, among other things, the third period of that hockey game. Right after this ABC News brief and a word from your local stations. One of the additions to our staff at these Olympics is a discerning ABC News reporter named Ray Gandolf. Ray wondered how best to give you an idea of what Sarajevo is like. He decided to compare it with an American city of similar size. Here's Ray's report.
Life here in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, bears little resemblance to life in Sarajevo. Different cultures, different political systems, different languages, different lifestyles. We'll show you some of that. But Harrisburg, like Sarajevo, is a capital city with a metropolitan area population of nearly a half million, like Sarajevo. It has a similar climate. And the more we poked around the two cities, noting the obvious differences, the more we kept coming across things they share. This church, for instance, St. Mary's Roman Catholic Croatian Church. It could be found in Sarajevo, but it's in Sarajevo, Catholics are outnumbered by Muslims and Orthodox Christians, but all are allowed, if not encouraged, to worship freely in this communist state. History will remember both cities for unfortunate events that occurred there. Harrisburg for the nuclear accident at Three Mile Island, Sarajevo for the assassination of Austria's Archduke Ferdinand, the match that ignited World War I. Industrially, the cities are moving in opposite directions. The huge Bethlehem steel plant in Harrisburg now employs only about 1,600 people. The city's once thriving railroad industry has all but vanished. Sarajevo's giant Energo Invest factory, specializing in steam separators for nuclear power plants, employs 35,000 people. There are several other factories, not much smaller. Sarajevo burns mostly high sulfur coal, and combined with the city's location surrounded by mountains and frequent temperature inversions, this results in a cloud of pollution seldom absent. Above the cloud, where most of the Olympic venues are, the air is crisp, the scenery magnificent. Even where cultures differ, people behave like people. Harrisburg, like the rest of America, wallows in fast food restaurants. Sarajevo is innocent of the Big Mac, but it has its fast food restaurants. Most specialize in cevapcici, hunks of meat and raw onions surrounded by heavy bread washed down with yogurt. And a kid being stuffed like a Strasbourg goose in Sarajevo shares the iron constitution of a kid packing away the French fries at McDonald's. Shoppers in Harrisburg tend to patronize the typically American suburban mall at the expense of downtown stores. Sarajevo has no malls, a couple of big downtown stores, but the bulk of the buying here is done at individual shops and open-air markets. And in the old Muslim quarter, craftsmen pursue their art in the back of their stores, sell their wares up front. Entering streets like Copper Alley is like stepping into a time capsule. All of Sarajevo is a time warp. Mile after mile of new, sterile, high-rise apartment buildings, broad streets filled with automobiles, coexisting with another century. A horse and cart. A tiny cottage. A yard full of chickens. You'd never mistake it for Harrisburg. And a pizza joint is a pizza joint. But at Mond Pizzeria in Sarajevo, owned and operated by the Hadžić brothers, Amir and Asuf, besides the pizza, you get four or five other dishes, the booze of your choice, and the latest music videos imported from Germany. Harrisburg, eat your heart out.
Well, you eat your pizza, eh, Ray? I have a couple of questions for you. First of all, how is the pizza?
It's very good. Excellent. It's got a couple of fried eggs on it, which I'm not used to.
But... Ooh, that is a little different. How big is it compared to ours?
About the size of a Frisbee.
Well, yeah, that's so bad. How much does it cost?
175 dinars, which is about a dollar and a half.
Okay, we had a look at the fried eggs there. I have one other question. Who's the pretty girl next to you?
Her name is Zamira. Her sister's name is Armina, and they are both as lovely as their names.
Okay. Thanks very much, Ray. One other difference I can think of between Harrisburg and Sarajevo is that Harrisburg has a horse racetrack, and they don't have one here. I miss that.
Well, I don't, so I'm keeping my money.
Ray Gandolf. We'll be looking forward to many special reports with the Gandolf Touch as we continue our coverage of the 14th Winter Olympic Games.
We're going to the third period at the Zetra. Canada leading the United States 3-2, a critical game for both teams, the opener of the Olympic hockey tournament. Another look now at the goalies, Mark Barron, and in the middle of that pack, of course, on the right, Mario Gosselin.
Well, obviously, this is the time where the leadership shows, and the people that we talked about at the start of the show, they have to come through. Mark Barron has to come through with a big save. Pat LaFontaine has to continue going the way he has. Chris Chelios needs to start to generate something from his defense position. And Phil Verkota, who is a veteran of the 1980 team and showed great leadership earlier this year.
There's Pat LaFontaine, number 16.
In 1980, the U.S. found itself behind many times during the Olympics, but they came back. This team, of course, can. The one thing that may be disturbing is John Harrington recently was talking about that, and he said when we're down by a goal this year, you don't see the same intensity that the 1980 team had. There were guys on that team that just refused to lose. So we'll find out about this team right in this next 20 minutes.
Third period begins with an easy shot right on Gosselin. If you're wondering, in Olympic competition, there are no overtimes. If the game winds up as a tie, that's it. A shot and a save by Barron, who had a pack in front of him. This is Muller now. He is spun around. U.S. trying to take the pressure off, get it out of the American end, and it is dumped up ahead. And right on to Gosselin's stick, where he leaves it for Robin Bartel, number two. Dave Donnelly now. Up ahead to Gagne. Brooke is with Gagne in the corner. Now it's Fusco fighting for control. Getting it up along the boards. Litster can't keep it in at the blue line. And a whistle for offside. Al Michaels with Hall of Fame goaltender Ken Dryden, 1980 U.S. Olympic hockey team captain Mike Ruzioni. And there is Lou Vero at the age of 38. Mike, your thoughts right now at the beginning of the third?
Well, I think what Kenny was talking about, emotion obviously is going to play a great deal of part. And I don't really see that. Again, I talked about it at the beginning of the second period. Emotion is a key to this team. And conditioning. I'm curious to see what happens with the conditioning. The key to us in 1980 to go along with our emotion was the great condition that we were in. That'll be a sign right now to see what type of shape this U.S. team is in if they can continue to skate.
The American keeping the pressure on as... A shot by Millen. A backhander went wide. Millen is able to keep it in at the blue line. He's scrappy, but out it comes down to center ice where Fusco, number six, takes control. Up ahead now to Gagne as he almost broke clear, but Gay gets it back to the U.S. Here comes Paul Gay in over the blue line. Driver bumps him, but Gay still has control. Gay looking for a centering pass. Instead comes out to Hirsch at the point. His shot is deflected high in the air. Knocked down and into the corner goes Hirsch, and a whistle will stop play. Somebody closed his glove on the puck, and that's the reason for the whistle, and we'll have a faceoff.
There's a point shot from Tom Hirsch. A hard shot, but you can see it's an unobstructed shot. Mario Gosselin had a good view of it all the way, deflected it high in the air.
If this game were to wind up in a tie, just as in the National Hockey League, each team would get 1 point. A victory is worth two. And in this division, which is comprised of six teams, the top two teams advance to the medal round. The Soviets are in the other division. Top teams in this division are the U.S., Canada, Czechoslovakia, and Finland. This is Flatley. Up ahead to Wilson. Wilson has scored two of the three goals, and Flatley the other. Darren Lowe shoots it into the corner. Flatley scrapping for it there. Now Gay comes back the other way. Paul Gay. In over the blue line as he circles back to Hirsch. Hirsch can't control it. Back comes Flatley along with Wilson on a two-on-one here. Over to Gary Wilson, and Wilson can't control the puck. Otherwise, he might have had a chance at the hat trick. Flatley gains control back of the net, and we've got a whistle because the net came off its mooring. So 2:40 into the third period, it's still Canada 3 and the United States 2. To get represented in Sarajevo, Yugoslavia. Home state, by the way, of Pat LaFontaine. As we're early in the third period, Canada on top, 3-2. U.S. team in white, Canada in red. Delio's able to keep it in, and he's shot. A nice stick save by Gosselin. Now this is Hirsch. Hirsch will be in front. He's shot, I think, hit the crossbar. It hit the crossbar and came back out. And it's tied up along the boards for a whistle. So the American team came that close to tying the game.
Tom Hirsch was allowed to come right in alone, let the hard shot go, and it just hit right at the junction of the crossbar and the goalpost.
So the USA-USA chance starting again. You can't help but think back to 4 years ago in that opening game when the Americans trailed by one, and it was Bill Baker who scored the tying goal. As we have an offside here, and it came with 27 seconds remaining in the game. And in fact, it's the only game in the tournament the Americans did not win, as they wound up with a record of 6-0-1. We'll take another look now at the shot hitting the juncture of the crossbar and goalpost.
Shot had Gosselin beaten, but as you can see, just deflecting away.
Minutes and 40 seconds remaining to be played in the third period. Again, no overtime in Olympic competition. A tie is a tie. Here's Millen coming in on the left side. He's taken out of the play. Harrington chasing after it in the corner. Millen goes over to help out. It's kept in by Fusco, but now the Canadians clear the zone. Redmond lost his stick. Now picks it up. The shot, meanwhile, is blocked by Brook in front of Barron, and Fusco is able to move it up along the boards where Redmond takes control for Canada. Taking the slap shot and in over the blue line comes Redmond, and the glove save is made by Barron, and with the American team changing on the fly right there, he felt it would be better just to hold on to it and settle for the faceoff.
If you had asked Coach Dave King of Canada what he wanted at the start of this game, he would have said that he wanted to get off to an early lead. He wanted to play a close checking game, play a defensively sound game, and play a high energy physical game. Up to this point, after 45 minutes of the game, the Canadian team has done just that.
And they lead 3-2. Back of the net. U.S. trying to take the pressure off and clear it out. Bukestad sweeping at it. He couldn't clear it. Puck batted high in the air, and losing his glove was Fusco, along with a stoppage of play now. So we'll have a face-off once again in the American end. It's a USA chant. Forever, that will bring back all of the memories of 1980. We're in Sarajevo, and so are a lot of Americans. Right now, the U.S. team trails 3-2 with 13 minutes remaining in the game. This is Olczyk for LaFontaine, but he couldn't get his stick down on it. Canada coming back the other way. Farfan gets knocked down. Chelios with the puck. The big five out there for the Americans right now. Chelios, Hirsch, LaFontaine, Jensen, and Olczyk. And icing is the call. on that play, had Jensen got to it first, it wouldn't have been icing.
Well, it was a bit of a clever play by goaltender Gosselin. You could see there perhaps that he made a move towards David A. Jensen. Jensen swung wide of him, allowing the Canadian defenseman to touch the puck first for the icing.
And it worked as well.
There's Vaughn Carpen, the Canadian player, being knocked on his back by U.S. defenseman Tom Hirsch.
It's been a relatively penalty-free game to this point, so the Canadians have capitalized on one power play opportunity. That came in the first period. Now the puck coming out to center ice where Millen has it. It's a two-on-one. Millen shot and a save off the pads. Another shot off the rebound. The puck is still loose in front. Harrington couldn't get his stick on it, and Canada's able to take the pressure off. But what a save by Gosselin off his pad. Now backhanded pass to Patrick, and again the puck coming out to center ice.
That was an extraordinary save by Gosselin, much tougher than it looked. Again, the shot normally would have gone to the opposite side. He had to be very quick.
Under 12 minutes to go now. Americans taking control of the puck at their own blue line with Gay now. Coming out of his own end to Fusco. Over to Bukestad. Bukestad tries to backhand it in for Fusco. Let him too far. Now the puck again controlled by Chelios. Chris Chelios grew up in the Chicago area, lives now in San Diego. He comes in and his shot is wide. Canada trying to take the pressure off. Can't clear it yet. Now they do. But Fusco gets it back. Fusco comes in over the blue line, but he has it taken away. And this is Doug Lister. And the defenseman falls down as Lister's shot is saved by Barron, who finally covers up. So the Americans with a big break of Hirsch falling down at the blue line.
A series of good action at both ends. Previously at the Canadian end, there were a good chance. And here's the last play when Hirsch falls down, allowing Lidster to sweep around him. It made it a 3-on-1, but Lidster was at a bad angle, and I think he probably made the proper play of the shot rather than attempting a pass.
Time remaining 11:16 in the third period. The Canadians on top 3-2. Lidster from the point. Stick save by Perrin. Clear to the side. Sampson moving it up ahead now. And shot in back of the net. Lidster tries to take control. Comes out toward the point. Bob Brook now keeping it in. David H. Jensen doing the forechecking, but he can't keep it in. And back it comes now, where Sampson tries to gain control of it. Jensen loses the puck. Now it's Wood with a backhander that goes in, and Barron got screened. Barron was screened, and the Canadians take the lead 4-2. So just like that, after Gosselin just minutes ago had made a big save to stave off a tie, a two-goal lead here.
The same sort of play as earlier in the game, coming away from the boards with it. The pass out in front of the net and just tipped. There's Wood taking the backhand. And it looks like it's Kerry Wilson again.
At center ice. This is Brook moving in. His shot is wide. Canada just trying to get the puck out of its own end, which they were able to do here as we approach the one-minute mark. Rakota loses it. Tippett passing it back to center ice. Now Chelios. His pass into the corner. Canadians trying to take control of it there, trying to get the puck back out to center ice, which they do. And we now have 45 seconds remaining in the game. So the U.S. team down 3-2 going into the period. The period starting promisingly with a quick flurry early on. But right now, just 35 seconds remaining in the game, and the Canadians on the verge of a pretty big upset. with a score 4-2. And the whoops and hollers that you begin to hear in the background from obviously the folks who have made their way to the Olympics from Canada, a team that has not won a gold medal since 1952, and a team embroiled in so much controversy, pre-Olympic controversy, right now 8 seconds away from a win.
About 2 months ago, I was talking to Coach Dave King, and he, of the Canadian team, and he was saying at the time that he could sense a gap between the Canadian team and the U.S. team, and I asked him how he felt as if he could close that gap on February the 7th in Sarajevo, and he said the only way that he could think of it was to go with a smaller lineup, to go with fewer players, that his fourth line was not strong enough, but if he went with fewer players, he thought they could be fresh enough at the start of the Olympics that it would really make a difference. And what he really didn't count on was the fact that the U.S. team, in a sense, would cooperate by not pressing the Canadian team to get them tired to use that condition.
So the final seconds of the game now, and for the Americans, they know that in 48 hours, it's Czechoslovakia and a must situation. But the Canadian hockey team, with so many other things, really, to distract them, especially over the last few weeks, comes out, takes the lead very early in the first period. The Canadians scoring just 27 seconds into the game. The U.S. tied it halfway through, but Gary Wilson countered. And from that point on, they were never headed. They led 2-1 at the end of one. They led 3-2 at the end of two. And win the game. The final score, Canada 4 and the United States 2.
That's the way it ended. After the game, by the way, we asked the American coach, Lou Vero, if he thought that the bitter dispute between American and Canadian officials over the eligibility of certain Canadian players had had any effect on the game. He said, yes, I think the end result was that it inspired the Canadians. A couple of other important hockey scores in the Olympic hockey tournament. First of all, Czechoslovakia easily defeated Norway by a score of 10-4, and the Soviet Union defeated Poland. The score there, no contest, 12-1. So, we'll be back in a minute. Back with us on ABC television at the 14th Winter Olympic Games, a lady whom I first met when she was 13 years old and the youngest member of the United States Summer Olympics team. She eventually became a gold medalist swimming champion. She tells me that back in the days when she was competing, all you needed really to get into the Olympic Village was a trading pin. But she's standing by right now. Is that really all you needed in those days, Donna?
And a smile, Jim. But now this pin is still the international calling card of the athletes. And more recently, it's been used to gain entry into some of the finest restaurants in Sarajevo. There are over 1,500 athletes here representing 49 countries. That's the biggest contingent ever to come to a Winter Olympic Games. And they'll take up residence in one of two Olympic villages. This is the main village. With them, they bring their hopes, their expectations, and a dream to carve out a place in history. I think this is the common bond, the denominator that helps athletes from all over the world enable to live together without controversy, without incident. Spectators come here to see events. Athletes go to the venues. They come back here. They live the Olympic experience. They take home the memories of this place. And that's why so many of the athletes refer to this as the heartbeat, the pulse of the Olympic movement.
The Athletes Village concept was first founded in the United States during the 1932 Olympic Games held in Los Angeles. The time of worldwide political unrest and the Great Depression, the idea met with opposition. Many felt the athletes from the visiting warring nations would bring dissension into this new living arrangement. Instead, the Olympic spirit proved stronger than the politics of the Olympians' own countries, and the new modern tradition began. Moimilo is the main village. Many seasoned officials and athletes feel it's the most modern and efficient facility in Olympic history. One thing is for certain, unlike athletes' villages of the past, this will not become a financial burden to the Yugoslavian community. These apartments have already been sold. This self-contained community could be anywhere in the United States. However, there are differences. A duty-free shop isn't something we'd see in our local neighborhood, and many of the souvenirs are typically Olympic. The official five rings noticeable everywhere. Everywhere, too, is the memory of one Olympic Games that ushered in this. Munich and security are synonymous. No longer does it take just a trading pin and a smile to crash the village gate. Inside, some 2,400 beds welcome the athletes. From a USA team floor, Soviet neighbors could be seen down the block. The dining hall is staffed with 500 cooks and helpers. Many of them not normally employed in restaurants have put aside their regular jobs to help make these games a success. Meals are served around the clock. Rush hour, reportedly 120 athletes can get their meals in 7 minutes. Entertainment and cultural events are planned. Members of the press are welcome. The official host, the International Olympic Committee, has a presence, as does the mayor's office, ready to sort out problems and welcome the national delegation. Disco and games are available to help ease the tension. All except perhaps this game, created after the 1980 U.S. Olympic hockey victory as a fundraiser for the Amateur Hockey Association, it pits the United States against the Soviet Union. A source of pride for the United States, for the Soviets playing this game, it's a reminder of a lesson they didn't come here to learn twice. 31 kilometers from here is the second village on the Igman Plateau. Already known as the Posh Village, it's what the organizers intended it to be. After the games, they hope this resort hotel will help this area become the Sam Ritz of socialist Yugoslavia. But all that will have to wait. For now, it is that unique neighborhood of international athletes known as the Olympic Village.
Donna, can you put your finger on the mood there right now, the night before the games begin? Is it quiet or noisy? Are they kind of up, or are they putting their game faces on? What's it like?
They're putting their game faces on. I think I talked to John Harrington, and he wants to do so much for the Americans out there, and he was down, but he says, we're going to dig in. We're going to work hard to beat the Czechoslovakians. There's a disco right here. There's athletes there, and I think they're just tuning in. Instead of counting sheep, they're counting gates or triple jumps.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you.
Donna DeVerona, back with ABC Television, and she, like all our special reporters, will have a lot of interesting things for you as the games progress. Tomorrow, the official opening ceremonies, and remember, that program will come to you an hour later than tonight's program did at 9 o'clock Eastern Time. Later tonight, by the way, ABC's Nightline with Ted Koppel, immediately following your local news. And then on Thursday, with the men's downhill, the real dreams begin. But tonight, those dreams remain just that. Dreams backed by young lifetimes of dedication and training. Here's John Denver with a song that fits the mood of those dreams that are so close, yet still unfulfilled.
Dreamers gonna find a way.